Today we're going to look at various aspects of cellular biology, but the first thing I want to focus on is mutations. Now, there are several fundamental attributes of DNA. First is that's where all the information that ultimately ends up as proteins is stored. So this is kind of the library, the blueprints for our bodies. Secondly, is that DNA is stable enough to allow for this replication. So you can get two descendant double-stranded molecules that are essentially identical to the first. But mistakes do occasionally happen. In fact, they actually should happen. And these are mutations. I want to talk about a variety of different kinds of mutations. The first one are called point mutations. These are where we have a base pair substitution. There are several different kinds of base pair substitutions in terms of their consequences on the physical structure of the body. The first are called silent mutations because they have no effect on our phenotype or our physical characteristics. Second are called missense base pair substitutions, and this will be a difference in amino acid sequence. And then third is we might have what's called a nonsense substitution. And as those videos showed in the last lecture, there is a particular codon that when it's reached, that says everything stops now. That's the end of the protein. And if you have a mutation in the middle of what's otherwise a long protein, it'll stop and be much shorter. So that's a nonsense mutation. So let's look at these in detail. Here we have a sequence of DNA, so we're going along Gattaca, 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 and we have the start codon that tells everything to line up ultimately when we get to translation. And then this is ultimately going to code for tyrosine, alanine, okay, and then you get to the stop. So in our genetic code table here, we can look at CGA, so that's this right here. CGA ultimately codes for alanine. If we then have a mutation, so that in the process of self-replication, it still does TAC, ATG, that's all correct, CG, oops, and then a T instead of A, and then ACT, so this is a substitution. We'll say this is silent because if we look at CGT, CGT, that also codes for alanine. So it makes no difference to the phenotype. It's a silent substitution. On the other hand, if instead of it being CGA going to CGT, which was silent, we go from CGA now to CCA, CCA codes for glycine. That's different. And now our sequence of amino acids along the protein chain are going to be different. Now, there are some really scary substitution mutations like this that have really profound consequences. And the first one I'm going to show you here is something we're going to come back to several times in the course. It's called sickle cell anemia. And instead of having healthy red blood cells that look like little hockey pucks, instead they are sickle shaped. And this, it turns out, is caused by just a single point mutation in the hemoglobin protein. The hemoglobin protein is a long protein with 574 amino acids. And you go along, and the normal hemoglobin at this region is valine, histidine, leucine, threonine, proline, glutamic acid, glutamic acid. But there's a mutation here. So instead of it being CTT, it's now CAT. And that then makes this valine, histidine, et cetera, et cetera. It's valine instead of glutamic acid. And that one point mutation has a consequence then of having a very different shaped red blood cell. So sickle cell anemia is caused by a single base pair substitution, which we refer to as a point mutation, in the hemoglobin protein. Normal red blood cells are hockey puck shaped, and they flow through our circulatory system quite well. They can squeeze through tight spots, they can turn corners, that's all pretty good. But these sickle shaped red cells can cause traffic jams. They block up, and so you don't get proper circulation to all parts of the body. And so this can lead to really nasty things like foot ulcers and other problems of physical health. Okay, so here's another kind of mutation. We're going to have an original DNA, so ATG, ATG, that codes for tyrosine. But if we then have a single change here, instead of ATG that would code for tyrosine, if instead this G is substituted with a T and it goes ATT, that's a stop codon. So ATT, that says stop. No amino acid will be delivered. That's just saying, okay, we're done. Start another one. And then another one is called, it's another form of nonsense mutation, where instead of having TAC, which is the start site, TAC, and that can start things or deliver a different amino acid depending on where it is in the sequence. But if it then has TAG, it doesn't know to start. And it'll try to deliver an amino acid, but no, nothing. It hasn't been told to assemble all the bits and pieces of the transfer RNA. So you wouldn't get that protein being synthesized at all. Okay? So as you can imagine, with these kinds of nonsense mutations, it's not just one little base pair and one amino acid that's different. There's a whole region of things that's going to be wrong or missing. Here's an important protein that is known to be susceptible to some of these nonsense mutations. Here is a rendering of what is the normal CFTR protein. It consists of 1,480 amino acids in a long chain, each one just so. CFTR is a cystic fibrosis transmembrane conductance regulator. We don't need to know this. The thing that I'm doing is, though, is to show you an example of a genetic disorder called cystic fibrosis. So this is the normal molecule. But the nonsense mutation, which has another elaborate name, W1282X, terminates the CFTR after 1,282 amino acids. So the normal protein should go along, each new amino acid being added on all the way out to 1,480 amino acids. But in this one, there's a mutation that occurs to stop translation after 1,282 amino acids. And so that shortened version of this protein then causes cystic fibrosis. And cystic fibrosis is then a hereditary disorder that causes lung congestion, infection. You get really a lot of mucus in the lungs. And it's a really horrible, heartbreaking disease that is found in certain groups of people. And these consequences are because it's missing about 200 amino acids from the normal protein. There's another kind of point mutation that alters the length of the DNA molecule, and these produce what are called frameshift mutations. The first of these is called a deletion mutation, where just one base pair is now missing from the chromosome. And so everything downstream here is off by one. So instead of this being ATG, coding for tyrosine, it's now got the C from the next codon down the line. And ATC, well, that's okay. That still codes for tyrosine. But now GAA is now shifted into being the new codon. That's leucine instead of alanine. And instead of stopping, we've got something else. And this can go on and on and on. So you've got a really weird new protein being synthesized because the codons are blindly going along in triplets. And after that start codon, it doesn't matter. It's just going to code blindly whatever it is. Another way we can get a frame shift is through an insertion. So you've got your long strand of DNA, but now a new base pair has been added. And again, it shifts everything along downstream and a whole new, entirely new set of amino acids into a protein. Now, as you can imagine, when you have something like this, this is going to be a grotesque difference, entirely different kinds of proteins than were ever present before. So these frameshift mutations are usually fatal, but they have been found in some people who somehow survive them to adulthood, but they tend to have a lot of tumors, they have problems like heart arrhythmia and excess cholesterol. But really, I think we can think of these as people like the X-Men, who are entirely different from the rest of us. Now, finally, today we're going to look at what's called splice-site mutations. Because remember, we have the pre-messenger RNA that has those introns and exons. And so all the system of the machinery of transcription is going to reunite the exons in the right order in here so that you can then have that translated and that becomes a functioning protein. But sometimes the introns are removed, but so maybe are some of the exons. And so where in a normal case, you'd have these three exons that should be spliced together to form a functional messenger RNA. In this case, we've got a bit missing. So only the first and third exon, the second one is gone. So this can cause serious problems. Here's a fairly common problem as these things go. It's called beta thalassemia. It's a form of anemia caused by underproduction of functioning hemoglobin due to these unspliced exons. Now, point mutations, silent, missense, nonsense, frameshift, all of those are point mutations. The rate of mutation is really quite low. In Escherichia coli, a gut bacteria, it's known from studies of what would allow them to resist infection with certain viruses called phages, that in that region of their chromosome, the mutation rate is only 2 per 100 million base pairs. So very, very accurate. Only very rarely is there a mistake. In corn, the Latin name of corn is Z maize. There's a certain area, region that codes for the color of the corn, and that's known to have a mutation rate of about 3 mutations per 10,000 base pairs. And then another gene that codes for yellow seeds, that's about 2 per million base pairs. In Drosophila, a fruit fly that's really well studied, the average lethal mutation is there's about 3 of those per 100,000 base pairs. And in humans, the best estimates of mutation rates are really pretty low, again on the order of 100 million here or tens of millions. In our overall genome, there are certain regions of our chromosomes that are more prone to mutation than others, and the mutation rate here is on the order of about 5 per million base pairs or 3 per 100,000. So we don't see very many mutations in any particular region of our genes, but given that we have billions of base pairs in our overall genome, there are a few every generation.